Below the surface of this Polynesian tropical paradise lies another world of incredible beauty, full of surprises, mysterious inhabitants, unforgettable encounters, and unusual friendships. Welcome to the South Pass of Fakarava in French Polynesia. Come explore with me this unique UNESCO Biosphere Reserve. For presentation purposes, fish species have been grouped by family. These yellow-tailed bacillus are typical of damselfish in that they congregate around coral heads, where they find refuge at the slightest sign of danger. Once the danger has passed, they resume foraging for food, but never stray too far from the corals. The number of damselfish in a given area varies from a few individuals to several dozen, depending on the species, the abundance of food, and the quantity of coral cover available. However, there are exceptions. This black barred devil prefers a solitary life. These yellow and blue surge damselfish live amongst the rocks at the base of the corals and only congregate in small numbers. Theirs is a secretive life, and they are much harder to approach than other damselfish. This trio of white-tailed bacillus seems to have the perfect life at the bottom of a quiet lagoon, with plenty of food drifting by, a good hiding place, and relatively few predators to bother them. This large colony of blue-green damselfish is certainly a delight to the eyes. The coloration of this fish varies from pale green to light blue. Again, they never stray too far from the protection of the corals, without which they would become easy prey. There are many images which can portray a coral reef, and this is certainly one of the most fitting ones. This orange fin clownfish is a close relative of the damselfish, but it finds refuge in a very different environment. It lives in a symbiotic relationship with anemones. The clownfish is immune to the stinging tentacles of its host. In return for this protection, the clownfish cares for the anemone, driving off its predators, and some clownfish have even been seen bringing food to the mouth of the anemone. Butterfly fish are a large family of colorful fish with bold and striking markings, of which these ornate butterfly fish are a good example. They all have the same general body shape. However, the variety of markings of this family of fish seems infinite. As you can see, butterfly fish have a rather pointed mouth, which allows them to access food otherwise out of reach to other fish. Pushing this adaptation to the extreme is the long-nosed butterfly fish. It's quite easy to see why this elongated mouth gives it a definite edge over other fish. Butterfly fish are usually found in pairs or in small groups, such as these raccoon butterfly fish. This group is basking in the afternoon sun, where it creates a beautiful scene with its striking markings set against the blue of the deeper part of the reef. This male butterfly fish seems to enjoy my company, or perhaps it has seen its reflection in my lens. And finally, we find the chevroned butterfly fish, busy looking for food, its main occupation throughout the day. Bannerfish are another large family of colorful fish, not at all dissimilar to butterfly fish. However, they can be differentiated by their large dorsal fin. In the case of these masked bannerfish, this dorsal fin resembles a white banner. These three-banded pennant fish are certainly one of the slower fish I encountered while diving here. But perhaps this is a strategy aimed at pretending that they are in fact a leaf, in order to confound predators. They often became immobile when I approached them. Whatever the reason, they are a very relaxing sight. The most iconic species of this family, however, is certainly the Moorish idol. It is easily recognizable because of its very long dorsal fin, which sometimes trails far behind its owner. One of the most abundant members of the tang family is the convict tang. Of course, its vertical stripes remind us of the prison uniforms convicts would wear in the early 20th century. The convict tang lives in shallow waters and can form large schools, numbering in the dozens, if not hundreds. One of the differentiating features of surgeonfish and tangs is a small spine they carry at the base of the tail, resembling the point of a surgeon's scalpel. In the case of the Achilles tang, this spine is black against an orange background. Here we have a group of juvenile orange shoulder tangs, where the orange patch is barely visible because the juveniles are a bright yellow color. This will change dramatically, as we will see with the adults in just a second. Now we can clearly see the orange shoulder patch because the adults have turned a dark olive green, although on this day, most of the members of this group are almost all black. In the case of the white-cheeked tang, we see that the tail spine is a bright yellow. Within this family of fish, first prize for originality certainly goes to the clown tang. This is one of the many examples where we can only surmise that Mother Nature does indeed have a sense of humor. Finally, we find the Dusumier tang, one of the larger members of this family. And because of its larger size, this fish is easier to approach. The most interesting part of this fish is probably the region around the spine, where we see a beautiful lace pattern of blue and green. This diminutive lemon peel angelfish is also called the dwarf angelfish. Its small size makes it more wary than its larger relatives, so it never wanders very far from its hiding place. You will notice the bright yellow coloring. For some reason, yellow is very much in style at Fakarava. The regal angelfish sports a striking pattern of yellow, white, and blue stripes, and almost seems like it has been painted by a young child. One of my favorites is the emperor angelfish. Being somewhat larger than the other angelfish, it is not as wary of divers. And with that purple band over his eyes, he looks somewhat like a masked avenger. And that is perhaps the feature which makes him most endearing to us humans. This pink-tailed triggerfish was kind enough to keep still for a few seconds. Usually, they are constantly weaving back and forth. With this lucky shot, we are able to fully appreciate the beauty and delicateness of its fins. This shy orange-lined triggerfish is much less cooperative. The Picasso triggerfish lives away from the corals and prefers the safety of a burrow. But like any homeowner will tell you, housekeeping involves many chores, namely maintaining the entrance of your home nice and tidy. Filmed at dawn, this yellow-margin triggerfish is looking for its breakfast amongst the pebbles and sand. This barred leather jacket is a close relative of the triggerfish. One thing they both have in common is an impressive set of teeth. They are usually harmless fish, but they have been known to attack divers and other fish when they are protecting their eggs. And largest of all is the Titan triggerfish. Of course, no matter how big you are, you still need to be careful of larger predators, but this one is safe for now. In this close-up, the fish might appear to be attacking the corals, but he is in fact picking off some other invertebrates which attach themselves to the corals. And here is one last look at that impressive set of teeth. These blue-striped snappers float peacefully at the bottom of the lagoon, content to bask in the sun, where they create a pleasant cascade of yellow and blue. One of their closest relatives, the humpback red snapper, prefers to congregate mid-water where it can form impressive schools. This much larger relative is perhaps less colorful, but was friendly enough to give us a very good side view. You might not see it right away, but there is a perfectly camouflaged grouper in this scenery. It sits perched atop the corals, waiting for unsuspecting prey to pass by. Its honeycomb pattern makes it practically invisible when it is motionless in ambush. This quite large peacock grouper, so named because of its blue markings and its spots, is perfectly calm amongst the corals. Its smaller sibling, however, is not as comfortable with my presence and prefers to retreat to a crevice in the corals. The saddle grouper has several large pale bands on its back, which look like saddles. This very large specimen is relaxing, content in contemplating his domain. At first glance, the camouflage grouper may not seem like a very interesting fish, but you will most likely change your opinion once you get to know it. Once a year, these normally solitary fish come from far and near to the South Pass of Fakarava to reproduce. Here we witness the very beginning of this congregation. A few dozen fish here and there, but soon there will be hundreds, and eventually thousands of them. The climax of this event takes place on the night of the full moon in June, when all the fish present release their eggs and gametes in the water in one large mass spawning. It is an exhausting event, during which many will weaken and be picked off by predators such as sharks. Those that survive will return to their former habitat and perhaps live to repeat this extraordinary event the following year. The following three species are presented together because they are similar in form, but are not necessarily related. These juvenile needlefish are hunting as a group for small prey near the surface of the water. Their streamlined body makes them agile and fast predators, and they are capable of attacking their prey with lightning speed. The beak of the cornet fish is much thicker, and its tail is more whip-like. The trumpet fish may look very similar to the first two, but it is in fact closely related to the seahorse. And like the seahorse, the male trumpet fish carries the eggs in a ventral pouch. Interestingly, the trumpet fish can change coloring quite dramatically, from an elegant gray body with a purple head, to a horizontally striped fish, and why not, to a solid yellow. Wrasses are a rather large and diverse family of fish, which seem to occupy several niches in the food chain. For example, these bicolored cleaner wrasses get their sustenance from ridding other fish of their parasites. Here we see a cleaner wrasse attending to a school of soldier fish. It nips off the ectoparasites attached to the skin, the gills, and the mouth of the fish. But looks can be deceiving. There are imposters in these waters. In the next clip, you'll see a false cleaner fish, which mimics the cleaner wrasse and suddenly takes a bite out of the unsuspecting larger fish. Now watch carefully the small fish to the left. Let's see that again in slow motion. Ooh, how painful that must be. Another interesting wrasse is this clown chorus, of which this juvenile form is one of my favorites. It is very small and shy, and quite difficult to film as it weaves about incessantly. But there is something quite spectacular about these orange and black spots. The checkerboard wrasse, on the other hand, is a much more common and approachable species. The slingjaw wrasse may look quite odd, but that is because its lower jaw actually works as a mechanism, which suddenly extends the mouth forward, forming a tube up to 2 inches in length. This enables the fish to more easily catch its food. This elegant Hardwick wrasse is weaving its way across the corals. Finally, we see the humphead wrasse, which is surely the largest member of the wrasse family. Only the males carry the distinctive hump on their head, and this one measures close to 6 feet and weighs about 150 pounds. Interestingly, this male was born a female. It is only when they reach sexual maturity that some of the females become males. These are fish of great beauty, and if you look closely, you will see the intricate lace pattern on its face. You will also notice the two larger moras attached underneath the fish. If anything, this retinue indicates that this is one of the largest fish in the area, and that he commands respect. He gives us one last passing glance to check out my camera equipment before he heads off in search of his next meal. And now we come to the parrotfish family, where we notice a great difference between the males and females of the same species. Take this female bicolor parrotfish, for example, who sports a mostly brown coloring with a large white band at the top. The male bicolor parrotfish is remarkably different, with hues of blue and green and a speckling of pink. In biology vernacular, this is called sexual dimorphism. And here is the female heavy-beaked parrotfish, in a glorious shade of orange. Parrotfish specialize in eating algae they pick off from the corals, which is essential to keeping the corals healthy. And this is her male counterpart, with a mostly blue coat. This ravishing daisy parrotfish seems very eager to pose for us. In fact, he seems to be fascinated by my presence. And here we have one of the largest of all, the blunt-head parrotfish. In this species, only the male develops the large forehead. Notice that the violet soldier fish has rather large eyes for its body size. This is in order to better see at night, when it is more active and hunts small fish and crustaceans. The giant squirrelfish is a relative who prefers a solitary life. I was lucky enough to encounter a large school of lunar-tailed big eyes. A rather plain-looking fish, one might say, but I could not resist the pleasure of diving amidst such a multitude. Like all goatfish, these yellowfin goatfish wear a pair of barbels under their lower jaw. Most of the time, the goatfish wear these barbels tucked under and use them to feel around for food. And not to be outdone by other species, here's an entirely yellow goatfish. Who of us wouldn't be tickled yellow by this pair? The variety of colors found in the reef is endless, if not astounding, as with the purple of these anthias fish. In the oddity department, we find the speckled sand perch, which scampers around the bottom on its fins. Highly camouflaged, it remains immobile until you get too close, at which point it prefers to find a hole to hide in. The diminutive Hawaiian spotted toby, a mere 2 inches long, is another very shy creature. These fork-tailed rabbit fish are usually found in schools, and they specialize in eating algae. You can see here that they are attacking the brown algae growing on the coral. These fish therefore play a vital role in maintaining the corals healthy. These five-lined cardinal fish live under a rock and come out at night to forage. For the archeye hawkfish, daytime is the time to hunt, perch high on its vantage point, atop a cluster of corals. These fusiliers cruise the reef in vast numbers, feeding on plankton as they go. The Antennata lionfish hides amongst the corals during the day and hunts at night. You will notice the long thin spikes and spots of its pectoral fins. The Radiata lionfish is very similar but does not have spots on its pectoral fins. The giant moray eel is another handsome fish, which lives hidden most of the time, preferring the safety of caves and crevices, from where it hunts for food. I was lucky enough to find this one in good lighting, and with two cleaner wrasses circling in the hope she would be agreeable to some personal hygiene. When they are not swimming and gliding around elegantly, eagle rays hunt for crustaceans in the sandy bottom using their shovel-shaped snout. Those large craters you might find in the sand were likely made by eagle rays. As she glides past us, this one reveals a delicate lace pattern on the underside of its wings. Of equal beauty are the spots on the top side of its mantle. But one of the most amazing sights at Fakarava South Pass is the abundance of sharks. You are almost immediately greeted by them when you enter the water. The most common are the gray, the white tip, and the black tip. The largest of these three species is the gray shark. It patrols the deeper part of the lagoon. These sharks are fish eaters, and humans have really nothing to fear in their company. Their preferred prey is injured or weak fish, but they will also take healthy fish should the opportunity arise. Their role in the food chain is therefore to keep fish populations healthy by removing the weaker ones, and also to control fish numbers. You might have noticed that the white-tipped reef shark is smaller and much more slender than the previous gray shark. Its elongate body allows it to force its way into crevices and holes to extract hidden prey. This specialized hunting strategy prevents it from competing with other shark species. Although the black-tipped shark might seem like it forages in the same territory as other sharks, it also has its own specialized method of finding prey. It goes into the shallows and sometimes right up to the shore to hunt, something very few other sharks will do. It cruises atop the coral reef flats in as little as 1 foot of water, and suddenly bursts into action in what resembles hydroplaning.